the Chinese have done is to make the argument in favor of Pakistan. अभी तक तो contested territory था, अगर contested territory
है तो आप वहाँ पर अपना investment कैसे कर सकते हैं? But the reality that became is that by traversing a project through Pakistan occupied Kashmir, the argument that the Chinese have made, not publicly but implicitly, is that they now recognize that part of China is Pakistani territory. So therefore, their position on Kashmir has shifted from one where they were saying it was a bilateral matter to one where, where they now are claiming that that territory belongs to Pakistan, and therefore they acknowledge Pakistan's sovereignty over that part. So therefore, CPEC in that sense represents a very interesting phase in China's India policy as well, because that is the shift on, in China's Kashmir policy, in China's in South Asia policy. So, and that is happening because institutionally China and Pakistan are linked in ways that we often don't appreciate. It's very easy for Pakistani elites and Chinese elites to get together. It's very difficult at times for Indian politicians who change every 5 years, for Indian party systems which operate on different bases to interact with, China, with their Chinese counterparts. So a lot of the time you hear this conversation in China that it's very difficult for them to negotiate with India because they recognize the challenge. Because they think in their worldview, what if today they sign an agreement with a BJP government, tomorrow Congress government will not recognize it? What if they sign an agreement with Congress and BJP will not recognize it? So from their perspective, that's a risky proposition to deal with Indian leadership. And Chinese, Pakistani leadership is easy to deal with. You give them some money, you manage them somehow, and then therefore any level interactions happen. So therefore this transparency issue which bedevils China has also makes them good friends with Pakistanis, Pakistani elites. So this is the institutional argument. The third is of course what I would call our normative arguments. But there are also normative issues here involved which I think which are from our perspective very, very interesting. That both of these states, if you think about them carefully, these are the states that have challenged global norms on major issues. They have been on the other side, on the wrong side of the global divide. Aap terrorism ka issue dekhiye, aap non-proliferation ka issue dekhiye. These countries have been on the other side of the spectrum. Chahe aap Pakistan aur Chin ka jo nuclear relationship uski baat kare. Despite being a party to the non-proliferation treaty, China helped Pakistan become a nuclear weapon state. Now, the biggest champion of Pakistan's nuclear program is China. After the US-India nuclear deal was signed, China provided nuclear reactors to Pakistan. So in some ways, on the if you look at globally, Pakistan is isolated. Pakistan is considered to be one of the most dangerous nuclear countries in the world, given the control of the military, given how they are managing the nuclear program, given the expansion, the pace of expansion that is happening. But for China, that does not matter. China has continuously provided support to Pakistani nuclear program. So this is, again, this is something that China stands aside the international consensus. Sari duniya ek taraf, ek bhasha mein Pakistan ko ek message deti hai, Chin usko support karta hai, ye nuclear weapons kam as kam, ya terrorism kam as kam. Terrorism mein bhi aap dekhiye, kis tarah se baar baar jab vivad aata hai Masood Azhar ka, to Security Council mein Chin ka protection usko mil jata hai. तो कहीं पर जो नॉर्मेटिव कंसेंसस है कि आप किस तरह से ग्लोबल गवर्नेंस चाहते हैं, किस तरह से आप किस किस्म की इंटरनेशनल ऑर्डर चाहते हैं, वहाँ पर ये दोनों देश काफ़ी एक विशिष्ट कंपनी में है. नॉर्थ कोरिया है, ईरान है, कुछ देश ऐसे हैं जो जो ग्लोबल नॉर्म्स को चैलेंज करते हैं और उन्हीं की कतार में इन देशों का नाम लिया जाता है. फर्क ये है, चीन बढ़ती शक्ति है, इकोनॉमिक पावर है, तो कोई चीन को अलग नहीं करना चाहता. पाकिस्तान इकोनॉमिक बास्केट केस है, तो सारे देश पाकिस्तान को अलग तरह देखना चाहते हैं और करने की कोशिश करते हैं. अब इसमें तीन सवाल जो होते हैं, नेशनल सिक्योरिटी, भारत की फॉरेन पॉलिसी और नेशनल सिक्योरिटी, व्हाट आर द इम्प्लिकेशंस अगर ये जो रिलेशनशिप है ये ऐसा है. उसके कारण ये हैं कि हर लेवल पर आपको कन्वर्जेंस दिख रहा है अभी, तो इसमें भारत के जो सुरक्षा नीति है या विदेश नीति है, दोनों किस तरह से और क्या उसके आयाम होने चाहिए जो इसको वो हैंडल कर पाए, इसको नहीं कर पाए. देयर आर थ्री वेज आप इसको सोच सकते हैं. एक तो डिप्लोमेटिकली आपको क्या करना है, तो ये तो हाउ डू यू डिप्लोमेटिकली मैनेज योर रिलेशनशिप विद चाइना एंड पाकिस्तान. And that is something that you, if you think about our foreign policy today, it's largely about how do you manage China's rise. Despite all the problems that India is facing from the Trump administration, the fact that Mr. Modi decides to invite Mr. Trump as a chief guest on the Republic Day tells you something that there are larger underlying realities, that you not only get the possibility of India being on the wrong side of America for all the problems that we have with the Americans, is a possibility that Indian policymakers are not willing to envision, partly because our challenge with China is now at a stage which we can't unilaterally handle. So the issue therefore becomes, how do you get like-minded countries which work with you? So हमारी समस्या ट्रंप साहब से बहुत ज़्यादा है, ट्रेड में है, माइग्रेशन में है, काफ़ी जगह दिक्कतें आ रही हैं. लेकिन ये जो रिलेशनशिप है भारत का अमेरिका के साथ, ये इतना इम्पोर्टेंट है अगर आप बैलेंस ऑफ पावर एशिया में जिस तरह से बदल रहा है उसके लिए, तो उसके लिए आपको अमेरिका की ज़रूरत पड़ेगी. उसके लिए आपको और जो देश हैं जो लाइक माइंडेड हैं, जो आपकी तरह सोचते हैं, जैसे जापान है, ऑस्ट्रेलिया है, वियतनाम है, फिलीपींस है, जिनको जो इस जो भी जो इससे परेशान है, जिस तरह से चीन बढ़ रहा है और आगे अपनी शक्ति का प्रदर्शन कर रहा है, जो असर्शन चीन का हो रहा है, तो उसके चलते जो जिस तरह से आपको समीकरण बनाने हैं, डिप्लोमेटिक, फॉरेन पॉलिसी, नेशनल सिक्योरिटी, दैट इज वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट. हाउ डू यू कॉन्फिगर दोज रिलेशनशिप. एंड सो देयरफॉर सम ऑफ दैट इज इन फ्रंट ऑफ अस. Some people may question why I'm inviting Mr. Trump, but the reality is that we have to be on good terms with Mr. Trump. We may not like him personally, we may not like some of his policies, but the reality is that he is the President of the United States of America, and we have to get on with him for all the problems that we have. Because our, if we had better handled China, perhaps this gap would not have developed. But the reality is that now you have a decade gap between your defense preparedness. So how do you manage China's rise? One of the ways in which you do it by building your partnerships, by managing those partnerships better. So I think this is something that will be with us for a long time. And therefore the relationships that we are witnessing around us, ek aur cheez ka zikr hua tha, some quad, quadrilateral arrangement between India, Australia, Japan and America, wo bhi chal raha hai. दूसरी तरफ मैनेजमेंट का ये मतलब है कि आप चाइना को भी बहुत ज़्यादा नाराज नहीं कर सकते. तो मोदी जी वुहान समिट, इनफॉर्मल समिट भी हुआ, कहीं पर आपको वो जो बैलेंस बनाना है बिटवीन नॉट एंटीगनाइजिंग चाइना एंड ऑल्सो डिटेरिंग चाइना बाय बिल्डिंग पार्टनरशिप्स, दैट इज अ वेरी वेरी इंपॉर्टेंट स्ट्रेटेजिक बैलेंस दैट इंडिया विल हैव टू डू. द अदर एलिमेंट ऑफ कोर्स बिकम्स व्हाट आर यू डूइंग ऑन द बैटल फील्ड प्रिपेयरनेस, एंड दैट्स अ क्वेश्चन इन अ सेंस that in some ways Indian Army Chief was raising when he said India has to be prepared for two-front war. So the question is, are we prepared for two-front war? Do we have the capabilities to be ready for two-front war? And that question ultimately is very significant. I'm with a think tank in Delhi these days, Observer Research Foundation. अभी हमारे एक researcher ने एक paper निकाला है जिसमें he has analyzed कि इंडिया की बैटल प्रिपेयरनेस कैसी है चीन और पाकिस्तान के खिलाफ, अगर पूरे टू फ्रंट वॉर पर बात करते हैं. और उसमें जो आंकड़े आपको दिखाई देंगे वो काफ़ी आश्चर्यजनक है कि हम बहुत ही अनप्रिपेयर्ड हैं. हम वी आर नॉट प्रिपेयर्ड इवन एट अ बेसिक लेवल टू टेक अ सस्टेन्ड टू बी अर सस्टेन्ड वॉर फाइटिंग पोजिशन चाइना एंड पाकिस्तान. दैट इज अगेन समथिंग दैट वी नीड टू वरी अबाउट, नीड टू थिंक that can we do that if tomorrow that happens. Doklam mein agar crisis badh ke ek conflict ban jata, agar war ho jata, to kya hota, uske kya parinam hote. Sirf ye kehne se ki hum khade hain, hum lad lenge, aise isse kaam nahi chalta hai. Aapko aapke paas kya ground level par taiyari thi. To mujhe lagta hai ye jo questions hain jisko aapko deal karna, aur isi liye jis tarah se भारत ने डोकलाम को हैंडल किया बहुत मेच्योरिटी के साथ, और उसके जो परिणाम आपको मिले विश्व में, जिस तरह के आप उसकी कवरेज देखें, तो उसको ऐसे प्रोजेक्ट किया गया जिससे भारत की जीत हुई. अगर आप वर्ल्ड मीडिया को उस समय रेफर करें तो उसमें उस तरह से प्रोजेक्शन हुआ उसका, जैसे कि भारत ने चीन को, भारत और चीन के बीच में जो विवाद था इसमें भारत को सफलता मिली. तो उसको अगर आप देखेंगे उसका एक ज़रूरी डोकलाम को रिजॉल्व करना बहुत ज़रूरी था, क्योंकि जमीन पर आपको ये भी पता था कि अगर ये सस्टेन्ड कॉन्फ्लिक्ट चलता है तो भारत उस तरह से प्रिपेयर नहीं है जिस तरह से उसको होना चाहिए. तो कहीं पर इंडियन आर्मी चीफ ये सवाल भी रेस कर रहे हैं कि क्या हम तैयार हैं उस चीज़ के लिए और हमको होना चाहिए और कैसे होना चाहिए। तो तीसरी दूसरी चीज़ आपकी वेपन्स बैटल फील्ड प्रिपरेशन की है। तीसरी चीज़ जो है वो ये है कि आपको तैयार रहना पड़ेगा डिफेंसेज आपके बेटर हों, कि जो चीन ने डोकलम में कर दिया वो फिर ना कर पाए, इसके चलते आपको अपनी डिफेंसेज बनाने पड़ेंगे। यू हैव टू बी बेटर प्रिपेयर इन डिफेंसिव पोजिशंस, यू हैव टू हैव बेटर इंफ्रास्ट्रक्चर ऑन द बॉर्डर, यू हैव टू हैव बेटर ट्रेन सोल्जर्स ऑन योर बॉर्डर, यू हैव टू हैव अ क्रेडिबल सेकंड स्ट्राइक कैपेबिलिटी, न्यूक्लियर कैपेबिलिटी, सो दैट द कंबाइंड माइंड ऑफ पाकिस्तान एंड चाइना रियलाइज दैट द चैलेंज इज नॉट सिंपली अटैकिंग बट देन इंडिया हैज बेटर डिफेंस, इट हैज बेटर डिफेंसेज, देन इट कैन टेक आउट द टू कंट्रीज एंड कैन इनकर कॉस्ट ऑन देम। सो द आइडिया इज देयरफॉर टू थिंक मोर क्रिएटिवली अबाउट हाउ डू यू मैनेज दिस चैलेंज। And then you also have this issue of asymmetric strategies. Can you employ asymmetric strategies in this country? After all, both China and Pakistan have been employing asymmetric strategies vis-à-vis the adversaries. Pakistan ne hamare against asymmetric strategy ka upyog kiya hua hai. चीन ने अमेरिका के खिलाफ एसिमेट्रिक स्ट्रेटजी का उपयोग किया हुआ है। तो कहीं पर हमको ये सोचना पड़ेगा कि हम कैसे हमारे जो लिमिटेड संसाधन हैं, रिसोर्सेज हैं, उनको हम कैसे बेटर मैनेज करते हैं। और फाइनली जो क्वेश्चन कहीं पर माइंड में रेस किया था कि फॉल्ट लाइंस क्या है, कि अगर आपको ये देखना है कि गुड डिप्लोमेसी इज ऑल अबाउट फाइंडिंग फॉल्ट लाइंस इन योर अपोजिशनल अलायंसेस, सो द क्वेश्चन देयरफॉर इज what is happening to the China-Pakistan relationship today and can we manage the fault lines that are emerging in ways that suit our interests. So if you look at the fault lines, there are potentially multiple fault lines, and from our perspective, from an academic perspective, we call it the limits of the relationship. ये जो संबंध है इसके ये कहाँ तक जाता है, इसमें क्या क्या परेशानियाँ आगे आने वाले समय में हो सकती हैं। तो सबसे बड़ा चैलेंज तो यही है कि चीन और पाकिस्तान के बीच में अगर कोई ग्रू है तो वो इंडिया है, और उस ग्रू को अगर आप उनकी इकोनॉमिक ट्रैजेक्टरीज देखें तो देर इज़ नो रीज़न वाई चाइना शुड बी कंसर्न अबाउट पाकिस्तान एट दिस पॉइंट। द ओनली रीज़न इट इज़ कंसर्न अबाउट इज दैट इट गिव्स चाइना अ लेवरेज वीज़ इंडिया। सो देयरफॉर समहाउ can you have a dialogue with China whereby you can convince them of the futility of this approach? Many people in India have been writing about it, that India should have a better conversation with the Chinese and tell them the real nature of the problem. Now that may be simplistic, but that is, I'm just putting it on the table, that is one argument that look, in the long term, it is in China's interest to engage with a rising power like India, not with an economic basket case like Pakistan. So therefore, in the long term, China is thinking long term, then it has to manage its relationship with India much better. Unfortunately, what we have seen in empirical terms is that this has not panned out. This is an argument that has been in the policy space for the last 10 years. कई लोगों ने इसके बारे में लिखा है, कई लोगों ने इसके बारे में बात करी है। जयराम रमेश ने पूरी किताब लिखी थी चिंदिया, लेकिन उसका परिणाम कुछ नहीं हो रहा है। हम का ऐसा नहीं है डायलॉग नहीं होता भारत और चीन के बीच में, लेकिन जहाँ भी पाकिस्तान की बात आती है चीन भारत का साथ नहीं देता और भारत का पक्ष भी नहीं लेता। तो कहीं पर चीन का मत ऐसा दिख रहा है बदले हुए कि हम चीन को पाकिस्तान के साथ स्ट्रेटेजिक रीजन जैसे जो हमने डिस्कस किया वो इतने इम्पोर्टेंट हो गए हैं कि वो अगर लॉन्ग टर्म वाइबिलिटी अपनी भारत के साथ नहीं देख पा रहे। दूसरी फॉल्ट लाइन आपके पास है कि दूसरा कॉन्वर्सेशन जो आप कर सकते हैं वो टेररिज्म के अराउंड कर सकते हैं। तो जैसा अभी जो वुहान में इंफॉर्मल समिट हुआ था तो मोदी और शी जिनपिंग के बीच में जो बातचीत हुई उसमें टेररिज्म का मसला उठा। टेररिज्म का मसला क्योंकि चीन पाकिस्तान की बात नहीं करना चाहता, भारत ने अफगानिस्तान का मसला उठाया। अफगानिस्तान में चीन के भी इन्वेस्टमेंट है, भारत के भी इन्वेस्टमेंट है, दोनों को अगर अपने इन्वेस्टमेंट्स बचाने हैं, दोनों को अगर अफगानिस्तान को एक सशक्त राष्ट्र के रूप में देखता है तो कहीं पर पाकिस्तान का लगाम करनी होगी और दोनों को साथ काम करना होगा। तो एक इसमें जो प्रोजेक्ट की बात हो रही है कि चीन और भारत दोनों एक साथ में एक कोऑपरेटिव प्रोजेक्ट करेंगे अफगानिस्तान में आगे बढ़ने के समय। हो सकता है वो चाबहार में चीन का इन्वेस्टमेंट बढ़ जाए, पर वो अभी बात वो वे अभी डिस्कशन चल रहा है, दिस इज एट द लेवल ऑफ कॉन्वर्सेशन एंड नेगोशिएशन, ये एक अपॉर्चुनिटी आपके पास है. दूसरी चीज़ की अपॉर्चुनिटी है कि फॉर्टनाइट है सी के एंड से रिलेटेड है कि जो टेररिज्म है, जो चीन जिस टेररिज्म को फेस करता है सिंकियांग से, उस टेररिज्म की रूट्स तो रीजन में ही है और पाकिस्तान उसका एपिसेंटर है. तो हाउ डू यू मैनेज, हाउ डू यू कन्विंस चाइना दैट लॉन्ग टर्म अगेन योर प्रॉब्लम इज गोइंग टू कम फ्रॉम पाकिस्तान, बिकॉज व्हाट हैज हैपेंड इन द रीजन, व्हाट चाइना एंड व्हाट पाकिस्तान हैज बीन डूइंग इन द रीजन इज नॉट फॉर द लॉन्ग टर्म वायबिलिटी ऑफ चाइनाज नेशनल सिक्योरिटी. सो दैट अगेन इज एन इशू. फाइनली ऑफ कोर्स द इशू इज यू नो हाउ डू यू मैनेज आइडियोलॉजिकली, हाउ डू यू मैनेज चाइना एंड पाकिस्तान टुगेदर. Is there a fault line that can be discovered? And there again the question becomes how India can convince both Pakistan and China that their interests with India should matter more in the long term than their bilateral relationship with each other. Now that's a tall order, that's a very long project that you can only do in the long term. Convincing Pakistan has never been easy for anything, so it's unlikely that they will do matter in this case. There are many in India who believe that perhaps China can have a more potentially beneficial relationship with India and look at India. We still feel it's very important that we have good relations with China. We are still working with China on issues of global governance, global trade. When Mr. Trump raised the tariffs on India and China, China and India together have come together and denounced those tariffs. So there are elements where cooperation between India and China has happened in the past, has the potential to happen in the past, but whether Pakistan can become an area of engagement is a very tall possibility given what we have experienced in the past. So therefore the question then becomes is then are we looking primarily at management of this threat? Are we looking primarily at engagement, building your defenses, making yourself better prepared for battlefield, making yourself better prepared for potential conflict? Or you are looking at a possibility where you can diplomatically manage this relationship in a way where the costs for Pakistan and China to ignore India become high and high. So two points I would just I'll finish. One is that if you look at India's Pakistan policy, India has done something interesting, at least in the discourse. Its impact on the ground is still not visible that much. But the idea is that look, SAARC is not working. And SAARC, if SAARC is not working, then how do you reconceptualize India's strategic geography? And then the argument becomes that look, again, you do not have to look at SAARC all the time, you can look at the Bay of Bengal government. So the BIMSTEC. So if you look at BIMSTEC, if you look at if you look at neighbors of the east, it does two things. It allows you to sort of for a while forget about your more troublesome neighbor, take a lead on regional development, bringing countries Nepal, Bhutan, Bangladesh, and join them with with Southeast Asia. So here Myanmar and Thailand, which are also part of BIMSTEC. So if this organization can get going as a region, then somehow the argument that SAARC needs to be viable becomes less potent. Then you can concentrate your energies there, and if SAARC gets revived later on, well and good. But so long as it's not reviving, let's focus our energies on areas where there is possibility of greater engagement. Now that is something that India has articulated. It's still not that potent, but the argument itself is interesting because that allows you to remap your strategic geography and say, look, this is a problem here, so let's concentrate on the Bay of Bengal and Southeast Asia. That also connects us to a larger, to a part of the world where we want to increase our footprint. So our neighbors can also benefit from that interconnectivity. So the engagement that India has had with regard to both Pakistan and China, and how do you reimagine your possibilities of overcoming the challenge that China and Pakistan together pose, as well as managing your own foreign policy in a way that maximizes the space for you, is perhaps a challenge that all countries face in their foreign policies. But for India, with two nuclear neighbors who increasingly act in sync, is a challenge that has a higher threshold perhaps. And therefore, the consequences for India are also going to be more severe. So if potentially India has to break that straitjacket, if potentially India has to somehow manage this transition from being a regional player to a global power, then it is very important to find some way of managing this relationship either through overt means or through covert means, either through cooperation, engagement, or through blatant adversarial positioning. And that, I think, is a debate that perhaps India should start having, and perhaps India can have in the future. Thank you so much.
We can have some questions. Needless to say, be brief, be pointed. Well, in young students, we have a lot of questions.
I would like to know about, like you have mentioned, all the things like BRI and the string of and India has also started the democratic quad in last decade, so with Japan, US and Australia. So in the, my question is, in the shadow of the ongoing Chinese financial crisis, when CPEC is going to get affected severely, and according to number of US and Chinese think tanks, when China is planning to put hold on its 380 billion yuan BRI project and 100 billion yuan Silk Road project. So is it a good time? Like you mentioned the thing about multilateralism and all that, and India should focus with BIMTEC and all that. So is it a good time for India? Like BIMTEC and SAARC, they are not more potent enough to cope with China and Pakistan thing. So is it a good time for India to reboost its democratic quad with Japan, Australia and India because of this financial crisis?
And you are a student?
Yeah, I'm a research scholar at HPR.
The story of quad is very interesting. I'm sure you know, but I don't know whether Ram or any others know that. The idea was first mooted in 2007. So in 2007 it was first started, and then both Australians and Indians for their own reasons decided that it can be too provocative. China ko kyun naraaz karna hai, agar hum ye kar denge to China naraaz ho jayega, aur isliye dono Australia aur India isse back out kar gaye. Now the result, what is interesting is that of course they backed out, but then a decade later it got revived. So the reality of, the potency of China's rise is so strong now that countries which at one point in time felt that why should we enter into an arrangement which can provoke China in 2007, got convinced into 2017 that no, that's the only way to manage China's rise. Somewhere China has become much more of a, as a power, as a rising power, much more potent, and therefore for these countries in particular much more problematic. That despite the fact that they would not like to antagonize China, they have no other way of managing China's rise than to enter into an arrangement which at one point they thought would antagonize China. So I think that in that sense, Quad is a reflection of what the underlying challenges that you face. And ultimately, even if you don't want to do certain things, you are being pushed into into doing those things, into building those arrangements. Because then a lot of the people in India perhaps very sensibly argue that look, we don't know, why should we be in the business of annoying China? We have to get along with the Chinese, and if we enter into an arrangement with countries like America and Japan, then Chinese will get antagonized and they will push us further. But then if you see it from 2007 to 2017, despite the fact that India did not enter into Quad and did not become a member of the Quad and did not take this idea forward, Sino-Indian relations continue to deteriorate. Similarly, Australia, which was a champion at that point in time of not having a quad, its relations with China underwent a change. So today, Australians are very concerned that Chinese are everywhere, they are influencing the domestic politics. So I think the concern for these countries is the potency of China's rise is so powerful. So how do we manage? So quad becomes a sort of a given that we have to do this, if not for nothing but just to develop some leverage vis-a-vis China, because we don't have any. Especially for India and Australia, they find themselves that look, China becomes so powerful and so influential in their vicinity that they need some leverage vis-a-vis China. And Quad gives them some leverage. Now the question is whether Quad can develop into something meaningful. It's still at a very nascent stage. Just two meetings happen, there are problems with this because all four countries have different ideas of Quad. It's not as if there is consensus on what Quad means and how it will go forward. There is also no, at this point, no plan for operationalizing the military part of war. So it's more really about soft power. It's more about what can these countries do in the realm of investment financing. So it's not really about hard power at this point. But I think from a scholar's perspective, what is interesting is that it became a reality despite